Check this out. This is an internal combustion engine with no moving parts. What's crazy is that this uses fuel. It could be gasoline, it could be hydrogen, and produces electricity. But what makes this so interesting is there are no moving parts. But unlike the internal combustion in your car, the producers of this light cell claim that this is between 70 and 80% efficient. And in an age when we're exploring alternatives to gasoline, could this be the answer, or is it all just smoke and mirrors? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. This video is sponsored by Henson Shaving. This is Danielle Fong, a high school dropout who ended up going to Princeton to study nuclear fusion. And in 2022, she founded Lightcell Energy. The company is developing an engine with no moving parts that converts fuel into light and light into electricity. They claim their engine can generate electricity at 70 to 80% efficiency. It has a power density of more than 5 kilowatts per kilogram and an energy density near 10,000 watt hours per gram. We'll put these numbers into context and compare them to gasoline engines and lithium-ion batteries here in a second. But there's one thing I want to talk about first. At first I thought this was just a new type of fuel cell. But then I realized that it works through combustion. That means that this is an internal combustion engine with no moving parts, a solid-state internal combustion engine. And that's groundbreaking. At its core, the light cell is a form of thermophotovoltaics. Here's how it works. You burn fuel to generate heat, thermo. You turn that heat into light, photo. And then you use a photovoltaic cell to convert that light into electricity, the voltaic part, and hence, thermophotovoltaic. Now, we did a video a while back on a thermal energy storage system that uses TPV to generate electricity from stored heat. The idea is clever and the claims are bold. Imagine having a tiny portable generator the size of a milk jug that can pump out 10 kilowatts and doesn't make a sound or produce vibrations. These things could power robots, drones, and even electric airplanes. But we've been at this for a while here, Tuba Da Vinci, and I'm more than a little bit skeptical. I mean, whenever you see multiple energy conversions in a row, the first thing I think about is how much energy is lost at each step along the way. So the first key to the light cell engine is energy density. Fuels have super high energy densities of 10 to 15 kilowatt hours per kilogram. That's at least 20 times higher than lithium ion batteries. That means you can make light cell engines much, much more light and compact than you could with lithium ion batteries and electric motors. The second real key benefit is power density. The chemical processes in combustion are really rapid and can release energy really quickly. Light cells work like a rocket engine where you continuously feed fuel and air. The faster you feed both, the faster they burn, and the more power you get out. Since there are no moving parts and the combustion happens in a continuous flow, maximum power isn't limited by friction, momentum, or how fast you can remove exhaust before re-injecting the fuel-air mixture like in a normal internal combustion engine. According to Lightcell, a unit with a total volume of roughly 1 gallon could generate over 10 kilowatts of electricity. That's enough to power almost everything in your house. They also found a clever way to turn all that heat into light very efficiently using sodium from dirt cheap table salt. Hot sodium emits very bright, nearly monochromatic light. Danielle's design can produce 3,000 suns of yellow light near the surface. That's nearly 3,000 times more light on any given square foot of surface area on Earth than the sun is emitting. But the real problem is harnessing that power. Not even the best photovoltaic panels are very efficient compared to lithium-ion batteries' round-trip efficiency of 95% or so. But they found an awesome solution to that problem. Lightcell uses a special direct bandgap semiconductor material that almost exactly matches the wavelength of the sodium's monochromatic light. That means that it's fine-tuned to absorb precisely the color of light that hot sodium emits. That material is what NASA uses as a top layer of the most efficient multi-junction space solar cells. The material can be 10,000 times thinner and lighter, 50 microns or so, than a normal PV cell. They say it's flexible, has very low resistance, and allows a very high current density. Trying to figure out the engineering in something is one of my favorite things. How about the engineering behind a great shave? Our sponsor, Henson Shaving, is a family-run aerospace machine shop that have built parts for the Mars rover and the International Space Station. Look at the blade bend in my Henson versus my old razor. The bend is closer to the edge and less gradual, resulting in greater rigidity. Also, look at how close the blade edge is to the support, minimizing flex even further. The blade only extends past the shave plane, about 0.0013 inches, which is less than the thickness of a human hair. These three qualities make this the best razor I've ever used. I also love the textured grip, making it easier to hold, and their packaging is entirely plastic free. You'll instantly notice the difference, and it's incredibly cost effective as well. You really gotta try it for yourself to appreciate this brilliant bit of engineering. Use my special link in the description to get 100 free blades. That's over 3 years worth, and experience a better engineered shave today. Huge thanks to Henson Shaving and you. Now back to the show. So what exactly is the secret sauce behind this semiconductor? Well, it's a bit of a trade secret. So obviously I don't know what exactly it is, but here's a educated guess. Based on the parameters and a tuned band gap of around 2.1 electron volts, here's what I'm looking at. Germanium carbide has a tunable band gap of about 2.11 EV, almost exactly the same energy as the sodium light emits. I also found that germanium is also used in high efficiency multi-junction solar cells in very thin sheets, so it could definitely be that. There's also gallium arsenide, another type of direct band gap semiconductor typically used for space solar panels, but its band gap doesn't exactly match at around 1.42 EVs, although some articles out there claim that it can be fine-tuned by adding aluminum. An alloy with 54% gallium atoms replaced with aluminum would have a band gap of exactly 2.1. At a very high level, the photovoltaic effect is when electrons are pushed into a conduction band from the incoming photons of light. For a photon to excite an electron across the band gap and generate electricity, the photon's energy must be equal to or greater than the band gap energy. If it's lower, it just won't produce any electricity. But if it's higher, the excess energy is usually lost as heat, reducing efficiency. So it's best if the cell's band gap exactly matches the light's wavelength or energy, because it minimizes energy losses during absorption. Lightcell claims it can reach PV efficiencies as high as 90% using a sodium lamp and band gap matched PV cells. With their current setup, they also claim that they've tested fuel to electricity efficiencies as high as 60%, but think they can achieve upwards of 80%. But of course, like all of these topics that we cover about breakthroughs, if this was so great, why aren't we already doing it, right? I do think there are some questions that I have. For example, why doesn't the glass tube melt when you're combusting fuels through it? And based on the research, it looks like they're using quartz to start because it's cheap and easy to work with. But long term, the company aims to use sapphire, which can take higher temperatures, but which also means it's more expensive and can thermally expand and break. The next question is, what happens to the salt? When heated, the salt melts and then evaporates and then decomposes into sodium vapor and chlorine gas. The hot sodium vapor is what emits the yellow light, but after it cools, sodium and chlorine recombine to form table salt once again. But looking at this diagram schematic, where does that sodium go? There's only two possibilities. It's all contained inside a sealed glass cylinder surrounded by the hot flame, or it's fed in with fuel. The beauty of solar panels is there's no fluids to top off. You just put them on your roof, photons hit it, produce electricity day and night, not day and night. You know what I mean? If the sodium is being consumed, you would need a separate tank to continue to replenish the sodium. So now you'd not only have fuel, but a tank of sodium chloride as well that you'd have to maintain. But Lightcell Energy isn't the only one with this approach to a light engine or solid state internal combustion engine electric generator. A company called Mesodyne patented a very similar thermovoltaic system that also has an internal combustion chamber. But this one heats up an engineered nanophotonic material. This material has small micro resonators that emit a specific wavelength of light when heated, and it's tuned to the PV cell's band gap, like we talked about before. So they're doing it the other way around compared to light cells. They're fixing the PV cells and tuning the light source. And you won't believe what Mesodyne called their invention: a light cell. Yes, they skipped ahead of Lightcell Energy and not only patented their technology 5 years before Lightcell Energy came out, but they also trademarked the light cell name. Now, I'm no trademark attorney, but I'm not really sure how Lightcell Energy is using that name, but I digress. There are several differences between lightcell energy's approach and mesodyne's. In mesodyne's lightcell, the combustion chamber, the nanophotonic emitter, and the PV cell are all integrated into a small chip, making it super compact. According to mesodyne's 2017 patent, they can fine-tune the lightcell to reach an overall efficiency of almost 13%, much, much lower than lightcell energy's stated 60% efficiency. The only prick is that it's much more compact and robust. But we have to remember that there's other technologies already in existence, like fuel cells. And fuel cells are the most efficient way to convert chemical energy and fuels into electricity. Now, they typically achieve between 40 and 60% efficiency, but it can go as high as 85% if you recapture waste heat in a cogeneration scheme. So why do people, very smart people, by the way, keep bothering to find better ways of burning fuels instead of using fuel cells? So ultimately, we want to take this chemical energy stored in fuel and convert it to electricity. And there's two steps to it. How can we optimize? Just showed Vaughn this sketch, how I would design it. And he came up with this. So imagine then on the inside, you'd have your combustion. You'd have fuel and air being ignited and burning on the inside. And then here between the glass and this outer ring would be where you'd have your low pressure sodium, kind of like a sodium lamp. That would give you this nearly monochromatic light. When you have low pressure sodium and you heat it up, you can get light at around 589 nanometers. Compare that to the sun, which puts out light all over the place. Only 42% is visible, 5% is ultraviolet, which is too high energy, which is just wasted in heat on the solar panel. And largely it's infrared. Again, not enough energy for the photovoltaic effect. You could get around that by converting all that into just one wavelength of light. That's the first trick. Imagine that this was copper, like a traditional heat sink, something like this. Or if you wanted to get even more fancy, diamond would be better, maybe graphene or something. But the idea is copper would probably be the easiest to machine and to create. But if you did that, and this was copper instead of PLA from a 3D printer, the heat from the fuel mixture inside being ignited would combust, heat up these fins, transfer out to here, while the fuel mixture, the exhaust plume, would be fully encapsulated and sent out the back. That heat would then be transferred to this heat sink, heating up the sodium. Now, to get as efficient a system as you can, you'd want the exhaust gas on the other side to be basically room temperature. That means no heat was wasted. Now, if you remember in Danielle's light cell model, she had that weird looking curvy heat recovery structure. And what that does is it blocks any light from getting through because that light would hit it and release its energy into heat inside of the structure. Sound even wouldn't really get through because it would be kind of muffled like a muffler inside that chamber. And again, transfer all that energy to heat. So if you don't hear anything, the exhaust gas is nearly room temperature, you would have 100% efficiency of heat transfer into our fin. But that's never going to happen. Let's say you can get that up to in the 80s or so, then you've only lost about 20% of your energy so far. The final step is having the PV band gap tuned for that monochromatic wavelength of sodium just right here means that you can capture way more. Traditional solar panels, like we mentioned, are only about 20% efficient because the sun is putting out a broad spectrum and only a part of that can be captured. But if we tune this system for around 589 nanometers or so with a band gap built for that, could we harness most of that energy? How much would we lose? And that would be the question. And that's the game. That's the engineering game. How do we take this fuel? How do we use this? And as I was thinking about this, I had one other idea. This entire system is burning fuel, kind of like a jet engine, right? In a continuous flow. What if we built a system like this on an internal combustion engine, like the one you have in your car? Currently, your internal combustion engine is only about 33 to 40% efficient. The rest of the combustion is wasted as heat. And that heat has to be taken out of the engine block with cooling loops and a radiator to the air, right? What if instead we took that waste heat and did this exact same thing? What if we took the waste heat, transferred it into a low pressure sodium system to emit light and surrounded that with cells? What if you could get the 30 or 40% in you know, in crank power to your wheels for the engine. And then what if we could capture the other 60% or a lot of it in this system to make electricity, store it in a battery, and have a true self-charging hybrid? That would get our efficiency up from the 40s to maybe 70 to 80. I mean, the options and the possibilities of an engine like this are incredible. And that's why I think it's such a fascinating approach. All right, that is the beauty of the lightcell engine. If you thought that was cool, check out this video next. And until next week, I'm Rick Tudor Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.